not exactly what we're looking for, but here we go. I got a recording going. So, you know, when you're doing a project and Rabbi told you about what it was that I did, ultimately the project was to create the first ever, you know, Jewish baseball player work of art, including all the ball players. And the first thing you need to do when you're thinking about this concept in your head is you got to come up with a slogan or a catchphrase. So what I did is I asked all my Jewish friends and they came up with some really awful slogans. So then I went to my buddy, Johnny Rapaski, Italian guy, not Jewish. I said, come on, help me out here. And Johnny came up with the slogan that I loved it. I picked it. We use it. And what we do is we call it, I'm going to see if I can get my arrows to work. Jews in baseball, the first ever all Jewish baseball player work of art where every autograph is real. So that was Johnny Rapp's signature line. And from that, I will let you get started with the program and tell you how this whole project came about.
You know, walking in here and seeing this painting in person, I have to say that it's probably one of, if not the greatest item that I've ever been able to, you know, put my signature on.
This is a wonderful project, just looking at all the names and great players from Sandy Koufax to Al Rosen, on and on and on. And I'm privileged to be a part of this and frankly, quite proud.
Always been proud of my heritage. And this is just another page in a never ending book. I think it's a great idea and happy to be a part of it.
Now, how did you come up with this idea? How did
you conceive of this idea?
So that's the question I get asked over and over over the years. You know, we finished this thing back in 2013. But with that question, I'll give you the story. It all started back in 2008. My son was 12 years old. He played in a little league tournament and they sent him to Cooperstown. And that's where we were fortunate enough to go, Baseball Hall of Fame. And ultimately his team got knocked out of the tournament. There was some protests filed, you know, some age qualifications and all that. But in sportsmanship, you know, the best of sportsmanship prevailed. We had my son, Sam, grab a kid from the other team, some random kid, 12-year-old, and take a picture. And here they are. So my son got knocked out by Big Billy, who played on the other team. And the reason I show that is, you know, Big Billy went on to play college ball. And fortunately, little Sam did as well. So it all worked out. But the most important thing was we got knocked out of the tournament. And that gave us a chance to go shopping. So we went shopping and we came across this incredible Negro League print. It was a lithograph. Ron Lewis had done the painting. He's a famous baseball artist. And he did this Negro League painting in 1994. And by the time we got there in 2008, 17 of these guys were deceased. And it was a lithograph signed by all 20 of them. And I had to have it. And I bought it. Ron Lewis has done some other great things. He did the 500 home run club with Mickey Mantle, Hank Aaron, Willie Mays. He's done the 3,000 hit club with all those guys who got 3,000 hits. But this Negro League piece was amazing. And I ran a foundation for a Major League Baseball pitcher. So what I did is when I got home, I took that. As much as I loved it, I donated it to the cause. We put it in the auction. And the black ball players were going crazy over it. They had to have it. So here we go. So they spent a lot of money on it. So I called the store. I bought another one. Same thing next year. We made a ton of money for the charity. And that's when it clicked. If I could do this for the Jewish baseball player lovers, the Jewish population, this would be amazing. So I contacted Ron Lewis and I just wanted to give you a look at him. And I said, Ron, I know you did the Negro League. I know you did the 3,000 hits. All these great things. I want you to do a Jews in baseball piece. And Ron kind of looked at me funny and said, you know, I could get a canvas the size of a postcard and that should pretty much cover them all. With that in regard, I figured, I don't know if you all saw the movie Airplane. It had a lot of great funny lines in it, but here's my favorite line from Airplane about the Jewish athleticism that we all have.
Would you like something to read? Do you have anything light? About this leaflet, famous Jewish sports legends. Yes, thank you.
So that line kind of lives in history, but now I wanted to do this. So the first guy I contacted was Steve Stone. He is a Jewish baseball player from the 80s. He was a good friend of mine. He had been to all of our events. I told him the idea and Steve said, Greg, that idea is amazing. It'll be great, but you'll never, ever, 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 I think he said ever 16 times, get it to happen. Because Major League Baseball will never give you licensing to do this. And Sandy Koufax, who you absolutely need, will never agree to be in it. So he told me to go home, go back into my little cubbyhole where I came from. And if I got any other good ideas, let him know. So a couple of weeks later, I called Steve and he said, all right, meet me at Goldman's Deli. So I'm showing you Goldman's Deli. This is in Arizona and you're probably wondering why, but just to give you an idea, this is a little tiny deli, has about six or seven tables in a strip mall in Arizona. So me and Steve meet there to talk about this great idea, how we're going to get licensing from Major League Baseball. So while we're sitting there eating our pastrami sandwiches, I look out the window and there's Jerry Reinsdorf, one of the most powerful men in baseball, standing right out there. He's the owner of the White Sox. And I'm just wondering, why is he standing out there? I look out the window again a couple minutes later, Bud Selig shows up, the commissioner of baseball. So here are these two baseball powerhouses standing right outside the deli. They were apparently coincidentally meeting for lunch. They came into Goldman's Deli. They got their sandwiches and whatnot, sat down at a table as far away as they could from us, which was maybe 10 feet. And Steve went up to him and said, talked to him for about 5 minutes, came back to my table and said, Greg, I told them what you want to do. They loved your project. You got licensing. So literally at Goldman's Deli is where licensing was born for this project. Bud made a call into the offices, told them I'd be calling. That's how we got licensing. Now the question is, who do we get in? Who are the Jewish players that we can get in? So I start doing my research and I get the whole list together. I go back to Ron Lewis, the artist. I say, Ron, you got to put together a pencil sketch for me. Let me see if I could pitch this to the players. We got licensing, but if the players don't want to allow me to use their license, their faces, their likenesses, and if they don't want to autograph these, it does me no good. So he prepared a little sketch. I turned it into a brochure and I had all the Jewish players that I wanted in there ready to go so I could pitch it to them. So the first guy, and I bet nobody knew this. Did anybody know that Yogi Berra was actually Jewish? Well, to be honest, he wasn't Jewish, but if he was, Yogi Berra would be Yogi Misha Berra. So we had a lot of fun with this project. Robin Yount is also Jewish. Well, not really. He goes by Robin Yontef. I'll let you think about this next one, Phil Negro. To fill in Negro. So we've had so much fun with the project. There's a million great players and I welcome you to email me with names of your own, but you know, I got the player, I got the picture there to the right, so you can identify. We got Willie Mezuzah, we got Carlton Gefilte Fisk, one of my favorites, and there's your picture of the gefilte fish, so I make sense. Roy Holiday is Roy Holiday. And of course, with the picture of the challah, because you gotta make sense here. JJ Putz, we just leave that one alone. No picture needed on that one. But there is one great player we got, Sandy Koufax. So how are we gonna get Sandy Koufax? My idea was, if I could get Sandy to say yes, every other player is just gonna fall like dominoes. So I tried to use my connections. Sandy's kind of like the great Oz in the Wizard of Oz. He never shows up anywhere. He's behind closed doors. Nobody really sees him. So I went to one of my friends, my connections, Fergie Jenkins of the Cubs, Hall of Famer. Figured Hall of Famer to Hall of Famer. Let's see if we can get this done. He couldn't do it. Reggie Smith, a Dodger, a friend of Sandy Koufax, couldn't get it done. If I don't get Sandy Koufax, this project isn't happening. So what did I do? I decided, well, let me talk to these other players. Let me see if I can get them. So first guy I went to was Ryan Braun. I wanted that marquee player. He just came off of his MVP season. And Ryan said yes. Then I went to Ron Bloomberg, first designated hitter ever in baseball. Ron said yes. And he said, yes, big guy. And if he meets any of you people out there, you will also be called big guy. He doesn't know any names. He just calls everybody big guy. Sean Green, next, yes. After talking to four or five of these players, I started to realize that, I was all worried about whether I would get these players to agree to do this. But then I realized it wasn't me begging them to be in the project, but it was them saying, you got to have me in the project. In fact, many of these guys, Ryan Braun, Sean Green, for example, they were so in love with the project that they made a place for their dad in the project. And I'll show you about that in a minute. But people always ask, you know, did you have to pay these players? You know, great players. Yeah, I had to pay every single one of these guys a player or pay them because they were ultimately going to sign 1,000 of these pieces if I could get this done. Norm Sherry and Larry Sherry played for the Dodgers. Norm was the first guy that when I asked him to be in the project, he actually asked me how much he had to pay me to be in my project. That was a classic, and I didn't charge him too much. So all good on that account. Now I actually paid him as well. But now we got all the players. Now it's time to figure out how we can get the great, you know, white whale, Sandy Koufax. So what do? I go back to my buddy, Steve Stone. You know, Steve Stone, he pitched in the 70s and 80s, and he was no shabby pitcher in his own right. He actually won the Cy Young Award, greatest pitcher of the year that year. So him and Sandy Koufax are the only Jewish people to win it. And Steve will tell you that there are two Jewish pitchers that won the Cy Young Award. One was great, and the other one was me. So he acknowledges that. But we decided, we met for a lunch, and Steve's always good for a lunch. So we met to decide, how are we going to get Sandy Koufax into this project? So Steve comes up with the idea. I don't know if you guys saw this, but Jews in Baseball just came out with that movie. And they actually interviewed Sandy in the movie. So he was, you know, willing to appear. And Ira Burkow was the director of that movie. And Sandy, you know, was obviously friends with Ira Burkow. So Steve knew Ira. Steve says, let me call Ira Burkow. I'll see what he did to persuade Sandy to be in the movie. And maybe we could do the same. So the problem was Steve didn't have Ira's number. He had his other friend, Joe's number, who was a mutual friend. Joe lived in California. Ira lived in New York. So Steve called Joe after lunch. He said, hey, Joe, it's Steve. Steve, Joe, how you doing? They exchanged pleasantries. And Steve says to Joe, hey, Joe, I'm trying to reach Ira Burkow. You got his number? And Joe says, you want to talk to Ira? And Steve says, yeah, I want to talk to Ira. And Joe says, hold on. And he hands Ira the phone. They lived on opposite sides of the country. They happened to be sitting together when Steve called them. And that was just the second moment that was Besharet. The first one was seeing, obviously, Jerry Reinsdorf and Bud Selig outside of the deli. So Steve talks to Ira Burkow, explains what we're trying to do, hangs up the phone. And then a half an hour later, Steve calls me up and says, Greg, you're not going to believe this, but I just got a call from Sandy Koufax. And he left it on my voicemail message. Steve was like a kid in a candy store, and almost like a copyright. Steve requires that I tell everybody Sandy would not have done this project had it not been for Steve. So here's what Steve had to say about Sandy.
But eventually Sandy came on board because he realized the historical nature of this particular project. And I explained to him that this is a once in a lifetime situation, that a lot of the people who are going to be signing probably won't be with us too much longer, and that Jews had an integral part in the history of baseball.
So here we are. We're about, you know, a year into this project. We've got all the players on board. We've got licensing. We just got to figure out how to execute this. But let me tell you a little bit about Sandy Koufax. You can see on the left side of this picture is Don Drysdale. And everybody knows Sandy Koufax was a great pitcher. In 1965, he was the best pitcher probably in the history of the game. So he was scheduled, and a lot of you know the story. He was scheduled to pitch in the World Series. The Dodgers made it to the World Series, game one of the World Series. Sandy's going to pitch it. Everything's great. We're going to win, except it fell on Yom Kippur. So Sandy chose not to pitch on Yom Kippur. With that being said, the Dodgers manager, Walter Alston, he wasn't too worried. He had Don Drysdale, also a Hall of Famer. So he had Don Drysdale pitch that first game. And Don pitched about 2 1/3 innings, gave up about 7 or 8 runs, just pitched awful. Walter Alston walked out to the mound to take him out of the game. And when Walter got to the mound, Don Drysdale said to Walter, I bet you wish I was Jewish too. So he wouldn't have pitched. But he took him out of the game. Dodgers won the World Series. All good in that world. Back to Ron Lewis, back to the story. I told Ron, we got Sandy. Now we got to fix this pencil sketch, make it good, make it great. Put Sandy in the middle, start really honing in your pencil skills and make them look great. He did Steve Stone. I showed it to Steve, and Steve said, you know, Greg, that looks like an 1980s porn mustache. He didn't like it. And I said, well, Steve, that's what you were wearing. You were wearing that mustache. So, but we took it out. We took out Steve Yeager, didn't want his mustache. And now Ron starts painting. And every time he's getting a little further, Ron's sending me a little picture of how it's going. And I'm getting, you know, more and more excited about this. And Ron's showing off. And here we go. We get about this far. And that's when we had our first call. It's word started getting out that this is really happening. And we had our first call for a charity event. The problem was, you know, we had eight or 10 guys painted and that was it. But what we did was it was for Team Israel. And we superimposed Ron's painting that he had already done onto a pencil sketch. And we put it up for auction. Not that, but they would get the lithograph signed by all the players once it came out. And it sold for $15,000 for Team Israel. And Ernie Banks was there and he's wearing this Cub hat and he liked the project so much that he actually took that piece home with him and it hung on his wall until he died. Meanwhile, Ron Lewis painting away while he's finishing up the players, I'm thinking about there's going to be this gallery behind the players up here. Who am I going to put into the gallery? I wanted to have some great names, great people, but they had to have some significance. So the first guy I thought about putting up there was a guy named Mo Berg. Mo Berg was a very mediocre catcher at best in the 20s and 30s. But the thing about Mo Berg is he was a genius. He went to Princeton and he spoke seven languages. So in the 1930s, the United States sent, Major League Baseball sent a team to Japan to play in an exhibition game. And on that team was Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, all these incredible players. Somehow Mo Berg ends up on that team. Mo goes to Japan. Well, what he did, because he was so smart, he was actually a spy. He went to the hospital building, which was one of the tallest buildings in Japan, went to the roof. He was supposed to be visiting a young girl. He blew that off, went to the roof, took video of the topography of the land in the city, and he brought that video back to the United States in his job, in his capacity as a spy, and gave it to the US so they could use it for their war efforts. So he was a genius. And what they said was Mo Berg could speak seven languages, but he could not hit in any of them because he just was not a good ball player. Next guy we got in the crowd was a guy named Lippman Pike. He played in 1866. He was the first Jewish professional player ever. So I had to have him symbolized in the crowd. Ironically, or maybe not so ironically, he was also the first professional baseball player that ever asked to be paid to play baseball. So I'll leave it to Lippman Pike, the Jewish guy, to ask to be paid. And from there, you know the rest of the story. Everybody got paid. Here's Ron Lewis just completing the picture, going through, adding the people to the crowd. There's Hank Greenberg. You know, the guys on the field were living. They were ultimately going to sign this. Hank Greenberg was going to be in the crowd because he was deceased. But he's also, him and Sandy Koufax are the two greatest Jewish baseball players of all time. So after talking to Hank's son, Steve, and Steve Stone and Jerry Reinsdorf, it was ultimately decided we'd put him on the field right in the center, right behind Sandy. Ron finishes up. Voila, we got the final work of art. You know, it took, we're probably, you know, a year and a half into this project. We got the work of art, we got the oil painting. You can't even imagine the thoughts that went through my head about everything that I wanted to include. I didn't want to mess it up and not include something. So you could see I put in, for example, every detail I could. This is a bat that Al Rosen's holding, and he won the 1953 MVP. So it says Al Rosen, American League MVP, 1953. These are the baseballs that Sandy Koufax is holding, and they say the seams of the baseball. Ron Lewis was able to paint MVP 1963, Cy Young winner 1965. The other baseball seams have significant baseball names. You know, Cal Abrams is here. Baseball that Norm Sherry is wearing, is holding, has his brother's name, who was deceased. You could see here Steve Stone's gloves, Cy Young. The beer vendor is an interesting story. That's actually, his name is Doug Davis. He's a Major League Baseball player for 10 years. He's the guy that I ran my foundation for. He's the guy that I donated the Negro League prints for. And he's not Jewish. So I put him in to let him know, you know, this all came about because of your charity That's how I got the idea. And I made him a beer vendor. So he thought it was pretty funny, but it hangs up on his wall in his man cave.
Excuse me, in addition, Greg,
to some baseball. Yeah.
Yeah. Wait, one question. There was a guy in a red shirt in the far corner of the stands. Who is that guy?
So that is the guy, and I'll talk about him a little later, but right here, this is the guy that bought the print at the Team Israel fundraiser before it was even, you know, done. And he bought a spot, which included him being in the piece. So I'll get to him in a little bit, but that's a good question. That's who he is. But you could see, in addition to just, you know, the baseball stuff, I also put other things, Judaism symbols. I've got a talus in the dugout. I've got a star in the dirt. I've got a chai drawn on the bench. So I just wanted to make sure that, you know, we didn't lose sight of this is a Jewish piece and people don't think it's just about baseball players. So quick trivia. I love asking these questions when everybody's muted because nobody can get them right or wrong. Here's some names. These guys all played in the 30s and 40s. Can anybody guess which of these guys is the Jewish one? And again, you're on mute. The answer is they're all Jewish. They were all named Cohn. They all changed their name because they didn't want to be known as Cohn and they didn't want to be known as Jews. So they changed their name to hide their identity. Al Rosen, 1953 MVP, played in the 40s and 50s. He also wanted to change his name, but he wanted to change his name to Rosenberg because he wanted to make sure that everybody knew he was Jewish. He was an amateur boxer. He was a tough guy, and he wasn't going to mess around. If someone was going to throw anti-Semitic comments at him, you know, he wanted to be ready. So after the quiz, now we got the painting done. We got all the Jewish symbolisms in there. I need to figure out part two. I got to turn this oil painting into 1,000 lithographs and get all these guys to sign 1,000 of these. I learned more about paper and printing and pens and markers and everything than anybody would ever want to know. We ended up with 1,000 of these that weighed 1,200 pounds. I had four of these cases. It's a little dark, but those are like those big cases that the magicians have and the girl pops out of it. They weighed 1,200 pounds, and it was planes, trains, and automobiles to get around the country to try to, not try to, I mean, all the guys agreed to be in it. They all agreed to sign, but we had to execute it. We had to get it done. First guy I went to get was Ike Davis. I figured I'm going to start easy. I'm in Chicago. He's got a game in Milwaukee. He was on the Mets at the time. Let's go to Milwaukee. So we go to Milwaukee. We get Ike. He starts signing. Now, I had told you that one of the things I had to get was Major League Baseball to license it. But they don't just say you're licensed and here you go and pay us a lot of money. They had a witness. They wanted to make sure this was legit. They had a witness, and this is Katie, and she was at 90% of our signings. And she was there to verify who the player was, that he was signing. And every time he signed one of these, she put a hologram sticker on it with an 8-digit number. And if you type that 8-digit number into Major League Baseball's website, now not my website, but Major League Baseball, you'll see that it'll tell you, you know, Ike Davis signed on this day, print number, whatever. Sandy Koufax signed on this day. And she wrote it all down in her sheets, brought it back over to MLB every time, and they entered it into the database. And that's how Major League Baseball tracked that these were legitimate. Like I said, Ike Davis, first guy I was doing this with. I'm a lawyer now. I'm not an autograph guy. I didn't know what I was getting into. Stuff was all over the floor. We didn't know how long to let it dry, how to stack it. We had to take a break and you know, sort things out. And Ike went and got his lunch, which happened to be a lox and bagel sandwich that day. But I got home that day and I told my wife, I said, I can't do this 35 more times. My back's broken. My knees are killing me. It took 5 hours to do. This is way more than I bargained for. And my wife, ever the encourager, said, you know, 35 more. It's not so bad. Just do it. So we figured it out. We started, we got tables, and there's my wife actually helping out. We got helpers at every site. So we had, you know, 4 or 5 guys helping. Here's Ryan Braun, you know, signing away. You can see we'd put a stack in front of them. They'd sign, we'd pull, sign, you know, their back hurt too. They were doing this for 2 or 3 hours. But Ryan Braun was definitely one of my favorite guys on this whole project. And what you've seen now is the easy ones. These two guys were in Milwaukee. So the next part of this chapter is, what do I do now to get the guys in the rest of the country? But before I do that, we're going to the seventh inning stretch with Rabbi Dan Gordon. I hope you're a co-host and you can do whatever you got to do to make this happen.
All right. So in a moment, Mike is going to play a little video about my favorite position, because first of all, my hero growing up was Roberto Clemente, the greatest right fielder ever. And when I was a kid, I played right field. And this is a song by a Jewish artist named Peter Yarrow from Peter, Paul, and Mary about the famous position of right field. During the song, you have the opportunity to buy more raffle tickets if you haven't bought them already by going to www.tbthumble.org. The ticket sales will be going on for the next 10 days, but while you've got it in your mind, go right ahead and buy some more raffle tickets, because you can be in this painting. So take it away, Peter Yarrow.
Saturday summers, when I was a kid, we'd run to the schoolyard, and here's what we did. We'd pick out the captains and we'd choose up the teams. It was always a measure of my self-esteem, 'cause the fastest, the strongest played shortstop and first. The last ones they picked were the worst. I never needed to ask, it was sealed. I just took up my place in right field. Playing right field, it's easy, you know. You can be awkward, you can be slow. That's why I'm here in right field, just watching the dandelions grow. Have lefties that pull. I dream of the day they hit one my way. They never did, but still I would pray that I make a fantastic catch on the run and not lose the ball in the sun. And then I'd awake from this long reverie and pray that the ball never came out to me. Here in right field, it's easy, you know. You can be awkward, you can be slow. That's why I'm here in right field, just watching the dandelions grow. Strikes on the batter, some runners are on. I don't know the inning, I've forgotten the score. The whole team is yelling, and I don't know what for. Then suddenly everyone's looking at me. My mind has been wandering, what could it be? They point to the sky, and I look up. You gotta know how to catch, you gotta know how to throw. That's why I'm here in right field, watching the dandelion grow.
So Jews not only excel in baseball, they sometimes excel in music. And Peter Yarrow also is famous for writing Light One Candle, a Hanukkah song, but Right Field is my favorite of his. And now back to Greg.
All right, great intro. I don't know, what do we got on me? You got the seventh inning stretch. You got a picture of Ryan Braun showing up.
You'll need to reshare, Greg.
Oh, I need to reshare? Okay.
Yeah, because I took over your share.
Okay. Got it. I'm coming. All right, we good? Okay.
Yeah, Braun's good. Right.
Okay, we got Ryan Braun is where we left off. And like I said, that was the easy one. Now we're going to figure out how we're going to get to Florida for the next batch of guys on the East Coast. So what did I do? I ordered specially designed cases for my babies. You know, these were signed by a bunch of people in Chicago so far. I got a bunch of signatures on there. They're precious. These are like bulletproof cases, perfect size, perfect padding. Everything's perfect. I got them sealed, I got them duct taped, and I'm putting them through to get checked in, to fly to Florida, and TSA opens every single one of my cases up, starts fumbling through everything. I was not a happy guy. I may have almost got arrested that day, but I didn't, and ultimately, it turns out they didn't really damage anything, so that was good, and then it was off to Florida, more rental trucks, planes, trains, automobiles. We started out on the West Coast, Tampa. We went to Tampa Stadium, and actually they had a museum up there where they had a little portion that was for celebrating American Jews and America's game. So it worked out well. That's where we did our signing. I decided I'm going to try to speed things up a little bit. I'm going to get five guys who are all available to come there the same day. We're going to assembly line this thing. And you can see I had five guys, Ron Bloomberg, Richie Sheinblum, Ross Baumgarten. Those are the retired guys. And then the two young guys. So the retired guys like Ron Bloomberg, Richie Sheinblum, they just want to kibitz. They got long names too. Those are some long names, Ross Baumgarten. So meanwhile, it wasn't like I thought where they're all lined up. I can have them sign one, slide it down. These guys were kibitzing. And the young guy, Sam Fold, seven letters in his name. I didn't think of that. He's signing, he's waiting 10 minutes for the next one to come by. So what we did is, to pass the time, Sam is actually a graduate of Stanford, really bright guy, but maybe not as bright as this guy, Craig Breslow, who's a graduate of Yale. Baseball players actually called Craig Breslow SMIB, S-M-I-B, smartest man in baseball. So while they were delayed and sitting there killing time, and the other guys are kibitzing and signing slow, long names, we were throwing incredibly tough trivia at them. You know, what's the capital of Zimbabwe? And they were just shooting out the answers, those two. But that's what we did on the West Coast of Florida with those two guys. Richie Sheinblum, you know, one of the guys that he just passed away a couple months ago, very sad, great guy. He was a 1972 All-Star with the Kansas City Royals. But his last year of his career, he tried to play in Japan. So he went over to Japan, he played for the Hiroshima Toyo Carp. And when he got to Japan, he asked for uniform number 55. And again, you're on mute, but nobody's going to get this. The question is, why did Richie Sheinblum ask for uniform number 55 when he went to play in Japan? And the reason he asked for number 55 in Japan is that in Japanese, you pronounce the word 55, go, Jew, go. So that's what he wanted to have. So Richie, love you, man. It's too bad. After we went to the West Coast, we went to the East Coast. Team Israel was in the World Baseball Classic. We got four guys there. Art Shamsky was the 1969 World Series champion. He was kind of the face of the team. Gabe Kapler was a player. He's now the manager of the San Francisco Giants. Sean Green was there. And then you can see this guy up front, Adam Greenberg. Now, I'm sure a lot of you heard those other names I gave you, and maybe not so many heard about Adam Greenberg. But let me tell you about Adam Greenberg. Adam Greenberg, he played, like I said, for Team Israel in the World Baseball Classic. Well, I'm from Chicago. So Adam was a star in the minor leagues, working his way up. And in 2005, he got the call to play for the Chicago Cubs. And, you know, greatest thing in the world, you work your whole life to get to that point. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to show you Adam's debut I wanted to show you the very first pitch that he ever saw in the major leagues. And here it is.
Adam Greenberg will be the batter, making his major league debut in this appearance. Here's Greenberg.
Oh, out. Man, he got hit in the head. The very first pitch.
Man, goes down. You can hear the thud all across the ballpark. I grabbed my head instantly because I really felt like I was holding it together.
So that was the first pitch. That's what you work all your life for to get to that point. And Adam said it himself. He didn't want to be a footnote. He got hit. He had vertigo. He had blurred vision. He had all kinds of problems, but he fought through it to try to get back to the major leagues because that's the major leaguer that Adam Greenberg is. That happened in July of 2005. And I could tell you that in 2012, he made it back to the major league. 7 years later, he got his chance back with the Miami Marlins. And that's the story of perseverance that is, you know, unlike none others. And I'll have to give a little shout out to Wendy Greenberg, his mom, who's watching today. You should be proud. Great guy. I'll tell you about another guy in this piece, Marvin Miller. Marvin Miller was 95 years old when I put the piece together. He was the guy that was the first ever executive director of the Players Association. He created free agency. He made these guys multimillionaires. And when I was in Florida, the plan was to drive up the East Coast and get to New York. And Marvin was in the crowd of the piece and he was supposed to sign him when I get to New York. But when I was in Florida, the Major League Baseball rep that was there came up to me and said, Greg, don't bother going to Florida. Marvin is doing very, very bad. He's probably going to die today. So just don't even bother. So it was very sad because, you know, Marvin is a hero to all of these baseball players. He actually just got elected to be in the Hall of Fame and he went in earlier this year. But my plan was I had to go to up the East Coast to Philadelphia to get Ruben Amaro. And then I was ultimately flying home out of New York after hoping to get Marvin Miller. So while I was in Philadelphia, the day before Marvin was scheduled, I got a call from Major League Baseball. And they said, Greg, we're calling about Marvin Miller. I said, yes. And they said, he's feeling good today. He said, come by tomorrow. He wants to sign your pieces. Couldn't believe it. So I went about 100 miles an hour to New York. I got there. Marvin was cheery and smiley, and he signed all the pieces. He told me the most incredible stories. You know, this man was president of the Steel Union before baseball. He flew on 4 Air Force Ones. You know, just great stories. And there he is in the crowd, and there's his signature. And he sat there, he signed them all. I kept in touch with him through his nurses, and they said that that particular day, whatever it was, he had a great day, and he wanted to actually go for a walk afterwards, which he hadn't done in 6 months, they said. So they took him outside. Another guy in New York that I was supposed to hit that same day was Michael Weiner, the current executive director of the Players Association. And Michael, same thing, with a brain tumor, was going through major issues. He wasn't sure if he was going to be able to do it, but he also felt better that day. Marvin Miller died about a month after signing. Michael Weiner died about a year later. And I was just fortunate to have met them both and include them in my project. When I got home from that trip, my wife asked me, you know, you met 13 guys on this trip. You know, who was the coolest baseball player you met? And there's no question, as quick as I could say it, I said, it wasn't a player, it was Marvin Miller. He was the man. Wendy, Adam was a close second, but Marvin Miller was pretty good. So anyway, now it's time to go to West Coast. We're going to Beverly Hills, like the Beverly Hillbillies. Here we go. There's the home. I don't know if you've ever seen this home before, but that's the home of Larry King. Larry King is a season ticket holder for the Dodgers, huge baseball fan. I wanted to have him in the gallery. If he's at all the Dodger games, he might as well be at the first ever Jewish game. So there's Larry. He signed them all. Him and his soon-to-be seventh ex-wife gave me a tour of his house. It was amazing. From there, we went to see Rob Reiner. He was great, told some great stories. Next, Steve Yeager and Norm Miller. So, you know, Norm Miller was an Astro. So all you Houston guys out there, you know, probably know who Norm Miller was. But Steve Yeager actually told the story that really hit home. Steve was not born Jewish. He converted. He met his wife later in life. He converted. And then his wife had a father that was a Holocaust survivor. And I told you a lot of the players wanted me to put their fathers in the stands. So there's about 8 or 10 players that have their fathers in the stands of this piece. And Steve was no different. He wanted his father-in-law to be in the crowd. But the story he told me is that he had 2 sons with his wife. And whenever they play any kind of sport, they always wear number 34. Because if you add up the numbers on their grandfather's Holocaust branding, they add up to 34. And they wanted to pay homage to him. Steve was not just a Jewish man. He was a great ball player. He was the most valuable player of the 1981 World Series. Next, you can see we were getting a little more organized here. This looks a little different than the Ike Davis days. We had our stuff down. Now we're off Rancho Mirage, California, to visit 88-year-old Al Rosen. Again, Al Rosen was the Triple Crown, or rather, he was the MVP in 1953. He missed the Triple Crown in his last at-bat by trying to leg out a hit and was thrown out by inches. And he admitted right there to me he was out. Otherwise, he gets the Triple Crown, too. But anyway, he loved this painting. He made me spend about 15 minutes going through every nuance, every player. And I don't know if you know this, Wendy Greenberg, but when I got to Adam, this is right after Adam came back with the Marlins. And Al said to me how much he appreciated Adam's perseverance. And I said, well, you want to talk to him? And I put Adam on the phone with Al Rosen. And it was a cool mix of generations of the 1953 American League Most Valuable Player telling Adam Greenberg how much he idolizes him. It was just amazing. If anybody wants to see that video of that conversation, send me an email and I'll get it to you. But Al was kind of afraid of ruining the piece that was already signed by all these other guys. So he told me to take out a piece of scratch paper, which I did, so he could practice his autograph. And he practices hard to see. It's in yellow here. He practiced it up there. And then Al spent the next 4 hours standing up at 88 years old, signing as slow as can be every piece. So it was perfect. He signed the last one, Hebrew Hammer, and gave it to me. And I still have that piece. Crazy, unfortunate thing is Al passed away about 2 years after the project was done. And I got a call from his son. And his son said, you know, Al liked your project so much that we want you to speak at a celebration of life. So here I am, some schmuck from, you know, Chicago, sold peanuts. I'm speaking at Al Rosen's celebration of life. Crazy. These two guys, we just scheduled them to come to Chicago. Joel Horl and Mike Epstein, unbeknownst to me, they were World Series teammates in the 1970s with the A's. They had a championship together. They hadn't seen each other in 30 years. They cried when they saw each other. Mike Epstein can still write his name phonetically in Hebrew. As you can tell, I could talk about my project forever. I probably will. Here's some more of the boys talking about the project.
A lot of greats along the way that not just great ballplayers, but great men. Marvin Miller, he was passing.
It's a remarkable project, and it kind of needed to be done, so I'm glad you did.
It's great to be associated with this project. Anything Sandy Koufax does is good enough for me too.
This is an awesome undertaking by all you people. And for me, it's an honor to be included with all these other great Jewish baseball players.
We're almost done with the guys. You know, I finish up. I'm in the commissioner of baseball's office, Bud Selig's office, crazy, Jerry Reinsdorf. Get to the last guy, Kevin Youkilis. You can't even imagine, you know, this is about 3 years down the road, how happy I am that I actually got through this project. I now have an original oil painting. I've got 1,000 of these pieces that we can, you know, use for charity and we can sell to people that want them in their homes. So just crazy that I got there. People have asked me a million questions. So I tried to put together some quick answers so you can kind of see some things that went into this project. And if you hang in there, you'll get your free gift options in a little bit. You'll have an opportunity to get any of these originals or replicas for yourself at a discounted rate because you've made it this far. But these are good ball players. These are not schluffs. You know, we got 2 Hall of Famers, 5 MVP awards, 4 Cy Youngs. There's 15 different guys that made All-Star teams, 21 championships under them, three MVPs for the World Series MVPs. A crazy statistic is there were only 23 guys in the history of baseball over 100 years that had four home runs and four straight at-bats, and four of them were Jewish. So almost 20% of the total guys that did it were Jewish. 413 years, we got five really smart guys that went to Ivy League. Some facts about the artwork people don't know, just tidbits, fun facts. 36 players, no coincidence. I wanted double high. So between the players and the guys in the crowd and the artist, it's 36. 29,000 autographs. Five players was the most I ever had signing at once. I went to 12 cities, seven stadiums, 10,000 miles. The last one's probably the most important. I have 55 people to thank who were in the room with me doing these signings at various times. And there's probably 200 more that have lived out this dream with me and heard my questions about, you know, who should I put in? Where should I put the chai? What should I call it? What, you know, every question in the book. But I went through most of the players, but to give you a little roll call, you can kind of see everybody that's in there. And nobody better to introduce it than Rob Reiner.
All right, move it. Here we go. You want to go, the last one. And there we go. Now we're done. Yeah.
Working hardest.
There it is.
Way to go, man. Good job.
Thank you.
I got beautiful. All right. So there it is. Now we've got the finished project. We're 80% of the way through with what we're trying to do. 90% through with this talk. And, you know, I just want to make sure I get a little, I don't even know if I can do this. All right, so we got the project. Here's what it is. Here's the painting. We have the original painting, and I want to tell you a little bit more about you know, where this all fits in. So I'm warning you right now. But what we ended up with is we ended up with 1,000 to start with of the originally hand signed pieces. They weren't cheap. Most of them sold. We have a few left if anybody is interested. But from that point, we decided we were going to make replica pieces because we wanted to give everybody an opportunity to own it, even if it didn't have the real signatures on it. So there's the replica pieces, which are definitely more reasonable. Personalized pieces, which I'll tell you about in a second. Most importantly, I want to let you know that, you know, I could do the Zoom event. I could do any kind of fundraiser for you live or through this event. I'm going to give you a little discount teaser if you hang with me, because these are good for Hanukkah gifts. But this is what you were asking earlier, Rabbi. In the right corner, there's a bunch of people, and you can see the guy in the red shirt. You know, he's significant to him, but not to other people. So there's a blow up of that corner. And you got the guy in the red shirt. You got Michael Wiener. You don't want to get rid of him. You don't want to get rid of Lippman Pike. You got my in-laws here. You can get rid of them. So what we did is we had a guy that wanted to be painted in. So we call that the personalized piece. And what the artist did is he actually got rid of the fillers and put in the purchaser. So they're in their own piece. And it's not like a Photoshop. He actually paints you in, signs it. He does such a great job that you can't even really notice that it's a new painting. So an interesting story on that is that one of the ball players, Scott Feldman over here, he wanted a personalized one. And he wanted his dad and mom in, which he did. And then he also wanted some other Jewish celebrities. He wanted Larry David, so the artist put him in. He wanted Seinfeld, he put him in. He wanted Adam Sandler, put him in. And he wanted one more person who I've X'd out there. The person that he wanted in was Israeli swimsuit model, Bar Raffaelli. And he wanted her in there in his bathing suits. And after talking to his wife, it was determined she would not be in the piece that was going to hang in their living room. So instead, Howard Stern came into the piece. They're about the same build. I'm not sure that Scott is real happy about that, but that's what it is. I did a book. I really wanted to chronicle this adventure. I had a videographer, as you saw, follow me around. So there's an hour-long DVD that goes with the book. And if anybody actually gets one of these and watches the whole thing, then you and my mother would be the two people that sat through the whole thing. I've done raffles, silent auctions. So anybody who's not from, you know, Temple Beth Torah that wants to get this for their own, let me know. We did a free art program where we gave away over 500 of the replicas to any Jewish organization that wanted to hang it in their building. And with that free art program, if y'all remember, you know, we like to have fun with this project. If y'all remember, there was that ice bucket challenge, which went viral. And it was for ALS, I believe. And we decided to do our own challenge, our Yom Kippur challenge, with our free art program. So here's a little snippet of the video that we did for the Yom Kippur challenge.
Rabbi, you want to take our challenge?
Oh, yeah.
All right, let's go.
Okay.
So I cut her off there. You know, you'd be amazing how many people took the challenge and got the piece to put in their office or whatever they wanted to do. We had some other videos. Fergie Jenkins, the Hall of Famer, helped me with some. And here's some outtakes you might enjoy. Oops, sorry about that.
What did I do? I messed up again?
Yeah, you stumbled.
I did. Got your Jewish ready?
Oy vey?
Yeah.
Or you say oy vey?
No, come on. Don't be a smuck. Spend a buck. A smuck.
This one was supposed to be don't be a schmeckle. Spend a shekel.
Don't be a schmeckle.
Don't be a smack. No, no. Jesus Christ.
You watch me. Watch me.
No, no, wait. Yeah, I know what to say, but you guys are laughing. Come on.
Anyway, we've done these presentations live with players. Ron Bloomberg is a frequent guy at all of them. We've donated a ton to a lot of charities. But the most important charity, Temple Beth Torah, today. So you guys got till October 15th to get your raffle ticket. It's only, I think, $25, five for 100. If you buy a ticket, you automatically get a $150 gift certificate. So you can buy that replica piece for 25% off is basically what it comes down to. You get an 8x10 replica. I'll tell you, I want everybody, you know, who bought a raffle ticket, we have your emails. Everybody who signed up with the temple, we have your emails. But there's a lot of people that got on here somehow through the scalpers world, and we don't have your emails. If you want to send me an email, I'll send you that same, the raffle people get more. But I'll send you the same discount. So you can use discounts to either set up your own event or to get the artwork. I'll send you info for your own fundraiser if you want it. If you want to do a fundraiser that's based on you seeing us here, we're going to make a donation back to Temple Beth Torah. So if you want to do your own Zoom event, Temple Beth Torah is going to get a little bit. But then when you do yours and people see it from other congregations, we're going to donate back to you. So there's a lot of different ways that you can benefit. Just send me your email if you haven't already been on the list to buy a raffle ticket, and I'll be happy to send you some free gifts. And lastly, I know you guys, I don't know why, but I'm sure you want to see the rest of that video. So here's a little more for you.
You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want.
Beautiful.
Rabbi Shmuel Katz, great guy.
Let me tell you something. Judaism, you shouldn't say too much oi. You should be a lot of joy.
I want to thank you guys. You know, this is a great project for me. I had so much fun. We did a music video, American Pie, but it was all about the Jews in baseball. I found a no-name guy, and ultimately he got signed as a country artist. So, but he's there when he's young and doing my stuff for me. So check that out when you have a chance. But in the meantime, you know, buy your raffle tickets. And I thank you so much for hanging on as long as you have. And I'll turn it back over to Rabbi Dan Gordon.
All right. Mike, can you put Greg and me on the speaker piece? Pin Greg and me.
And I'm going to hang around as long as anybody wants to answer any questions, anything you guys need.
So
I have you both spotlighted.
A couple of quick things. First of all, the last slide said you have till October 15th. It's October 13th. That the cutoff for purchase tickets is October 13th. And October 15th is when the drawing will be, and it'll be announced on Zoom. And if you're not at Shabbat services, well, then you're not at Shabbat services. What can I say? But if you win and you're not at Shabbat services, you'll still win. What you will win if you win is the option of putting yourself or someone else you like in the painting. We went for the bigger prize, and it's a canvas painting. It's terrific, and you will get. You'll be able to put whoever you want, one person. But if you want multiple people, then you negotiate with Greg, and for an extra fee, you can add other people. One person comes to the winner. If you want to buy the painting, if you didn't win, then as he said, a portion will go to Temple Beth Torah because you saw it here first. And also, if you just want to make a donation to Temple Beth Torah, why not? We do have a couple of other Houston connections that you should know about, Greg. Andrew Friedman, do you know who he is?
Sure.
Yeah. So Andrew Friedman is president of baseball operations or something for the Dodgers?
Bring him on.
Yep.
He was a little younger when I did the project, though. So.
Yep. He grew up in Houston, right? And Alex Bregman, of course. Came into Major League Baseball after the project was done. And so we have a lot of excitement here. Hey, if anyone has a question for Greg and wants to unmute yourself, go right ahead.
Yeah, and I'm also
Greg.
In the chat as well, but let's see what we got.
Greg.
Yes, sir.
I have a question. Do you know who Martin Kay is? He's any one of Jerry Reinsdorf's partners?
I don't know who he is.
He was in our temple one time. He's had something to do with the Chicago White Sox.
You know, it's funny because when I was meeting with Steve Stone once, and we were talking about it, you know, we said we're going to do this thing with Jewish players and we can fit most of them on a canvas. And we talked about it. We said if we did executives, we would need a heck of a lot bigger canvas. And if we did Jewish orthopedic surgeons, we would need one the size of O'Hare Airport. So, you know, there's a limit of what we could do, but we tried to get in some major, major guys, but I do not know him. Sorry about that.
I was just worried because what happened was he came to our temple for a bar mitzvah once. And the rabbi was talking of the rabbi was before Rabbi Gordon was here, was when our previous rabbi was here. And somebody started talking about baseball.
Uh-huh.
So he started about baseball and somebody, and he turned around his wife. He turned around and looked around. And so after the service was over, I went and asked him, he said, you know, I'm one of the owners of the Chicago White Sox. He's a minority owner of the White Sox. He was in our temple all back about 20 years ago, 25, maybe a long time ago.
Kol Nidre this year, there was a sports personality by the name of Barry Warner, who was, he was for about 40 years on talk radio, and he happened to be at Kol Nidre services, and he saw the painting, and he looked right at Norm Miller, and he said, I just talked to him today. And a lady called me who saw the article in the Herald Voice, who told me that she is Norm Miller's wife's best friend.
Norm was a great guy to work with. He lives out in Oregon, I believe, right now. But he's also, you know, always willing to do these these presentations or fundraisers if we need them. I'm skimming through some of the questions just to I'll throw out some answers to some stuff I'm seeing. You know, how did I verify that they were Jewish? What I did is I would have a moyel in each city. No, I'm just kidding. If they were, you know, if they had a drop of Jewish blood in them and they wanted to be in this project, honestly, that was good enough for me. There's guys that had a lot of Jewish blood in them that did not want to be in the project. You know, Paul Goldschmidt, he grew up, you know, just totally not of Jewish faith, and he just felt awkward about it. He was very nice about it. Jason Kipnis is from the Chicago area, and he has a father that's Jewish and a mother that's not, and he wears a big cross, and he didn't feel good about it. You know, there's different levels. Mike Epstein is very, very Jewish. Brad Ausmus is in it. Does he practice? Not really. So, you know, it was really a drop of Jewish blood, you know, was enough for me. I did read in all the reading I read when I was doing this, there was one piece that said Max Scherzer was Jewish. And I was, you know, this time, at this point in 2011, he wasn't Max Scherzer like he is today, but he was getting there. And he actually was a teammate of Doug Davis's, who he came to all my events. So I called Max and I said, Max, you know, are you going to do this? And he said, no, he said, it's wrong. So I would have loved to have gotten Max in there because we'd have another Hall of Famer. One of the questions I see from Bennett, you know, I probably won't see this guy ever in my life until next week. Bennett asked if we could personalize it and have someone be in the picture, but in uniform on the field. And the answer is yes, we can. And we've done it. You guys should all watch. There was a story on ESPN Short Sports. I think the guy's name was Barry Bremen. He was the great imposter. He would go to stadiums. He would have uniform. He would hop on the field. He would shag fly balls. He would be in the layup line in the All-Star game. And so he ultimately passed away, but his wife bought one and said, he's always on the field. We got to put him on the field in uniform. So we did. We put Barry Bremen on the field in a Yankee uniform. We've put bat boys for bar mitzvah presents. We put them on the field as a bat boy, personalize it that way. And then we make the 8x10s, you know, of that one, of the bat boy. And everybody at the bar mitzvah gets an 8x10, you know, Joey's bar mitzvah with him in it. So that's a pretty cool one. I'm looking through any other questions while I'm scrolling through here.
Greg, while I've got you, first of all, great presentation. Rabbi, thank you for sponsoring Greg and bringing him to Houston, even if it's only virtually. You're right about Barry Warner. He's an old friend of mine, and he gave me the book it's basically an autobiography of Norm Miller, but I think it was co-written, and I can't remember who the writer was, but very down-to-earth kind of guy. And Greg, thanks again. I will see you in a couple of weeks on the field. And I really enjoyed this.
Thanks, Bennett. I'm looking, Barbara Heller, when did you start this project? You know, it was 2008 was Cooperstown. I sat on it for a couple of years. And then in 2010 is when I met with Steve Stone, and it didn't get released. It didn't get finished till 2013. So it was, you know, truly a project of passion to do that. Someone's asking if I can get them literature on the different options and fundraising. Just email me at, you know, greg@jewishbaseballplayer.com. Player is singular. Greg has, you know, one G. But you can email me or email Rabbi and he'll get me the message and I can get you whatever fundraising stuff you're looking for. Todd, who's this? Todd Wine. What was it like to meet Koufax? You mind if should I go through these, Rabbi, or you want to take charge?
No, go ahead.
What was it like to meet Koufax? Did he do the signing in a public space? So, oh, thanks. He just put my email in the chat line. You know, Koufax was cordial. You know, everyone thinks, oh, it must have been the greatest thing. I can tell you this. We scheduled his signing for October, you know, 12th or whatever date it was. And in, you know, late August, I told my wife, I said, you know, Sam, our son, he's going to be sick for school October 12th. And she said, how do you know? I said, I know. And so he flew to Florida with me and his buddy Emmett Price. And and Mark Price, who was a cameo in the Rabbi video, throwing the water. But anyway, Koufax was very cordial, very nice, but they did not want any videos taken of him while he was signing. It was done in a private hotel, a medium-sized conference room in a hotel. He kind of came in directly from the parking lot to the hotel. I've had many people that think I'm his agent and I can get them to do their fundraisers. They've offered, you know, $100,000 to have him go to dinner 20 minutes from his house for a temple, and he won't do it. So, you know, it's just, he doesn't need the money. He needs his privacy, I guess. But, you know, nice enough guy. But like I said, he was kind of quiet.
I'll mention quickly two other Houston connections. You mentioned Brad Auspice, who was happy to be in the painting and had played for Team Israel. I think he actually managed in the World Baseball Classic once. But somebody told me that they ran into Brad Auspice at a restaurant on Yom Kippur. And I didn't bother asking them why they were at a restaurant on Yom Kippur, because I don't do that. The other nice Jewish connection we have is Josh Zide, who played parts of two seasons for the Astros. He played in the Olympics this year for Team Israel. I officiated his wedding, and I wrote a letter because all the players who played for the Olympics had to become official residents of Israel. So I wrote a letter for him verifying his Jewishness so that he could officially make Aliyah. He didn't quite make it as a major leaguer, but it was a very special moment that he put on Facebook, because I also named his two sons, and his younger son, his sons had never seen him pitch because he had already retired. And so they got a chance to watch him pitch in the Olympics. And that was a very special moment for him.
You know, Josh actually did play in the majors. He had a little stint. So
parts of two seasons for the Astros.
Yeah. And he played back, like you said, when Brad Auspice was the manager. Without getting into details, I knew that if I had to say who was the least religious in this piece, I might say Brad. I don't know. I just might. He was happy to sign and be a part of it. And he's actually, you know, one of the bigger names for sure. So I was glad to have him in the piece.
You got any other questions in the chat?
Any questions?
All right. Well, I don't think there's any better way to finish a presentation like this than Adon Olam. Adonolam Asher Malach Beterem Kol Yitzir Nivra Liyed Nasa Behepsako Azay Melech Shemo Nikra Via Karei Kichlo Tako Levado Yimok Nora Behu Aya Behu Oveh Behu Yiyeh Betifara. Play ball.
Hey.
Thank you everyone for coming. You can still buy raffle tickets up until October 13th. If you're sending a check, please make sure it gets into the mail before then. There's a bank holiday before that. And good luck to everyone who bought a ticket, and someone's going to get a really terrific prize.
Thanks a lot, Rabbi. I really appreciate it.
Thanks, Greg. We'll have a lot of fun with this in the future. Be well.
If anybody has any other questions, they can email me directly. Thank you.